myself, but we don't have a lot of time. This slideshow is going to be about an hour and 2 minutes. So if you have questions, feel free to write down a piece of paper provided, and I'll try to get to them at the end of the presentation. So we can make sure we get through everything. I don't want anybody to have a slip in here after rather than that show we're seeing. So this first slide, you can find on page 2 of your handout. All the information. But what I want to convey is the size of the thing. If you put anything on the UPS campus, it's good from McIntyre Hall, and to Thomas. And walk steps, that's how long we walk. So Titanic was built by the Harlem Hall Shipyards of Belfast, Ireland, in slipway number 3. It is the 400th and first ship to be built by Harlan Wolff. That's what gives the hull number 401. Construction began on March 31st of 1909 with the laying of the keel plate with the backbone of the ship. Through the keel plate, the frames were erected, all 302, with the shell plating was then put on the ship. By March 30th of 1911, 1911, Titanic was ready to be launched into the waters of Belfast. The launching occurred on May 31st, 1911, and was witnessed by 100,000 people. At this point, the hull was an empty shell weighing about 25,000 tons, and it took 62 seconds for it to slide from the land into the water. Once launched, it was time for the fitting up to begin, which consisted of putting in the machinery, putting on the funnels, putting on the wooden decks, both interior and exterior, putting in more than 200 miles of electrical wires, and pretty much everything that needed to be finished with the ship. Painting the hull, putting on propellers, so on and so forth. After 4 years of construction, Titanic was ready for a sea trials, which were to take place on April 1st, but due to weather conditions, it was postponed until the next evening, or next morning, at 6 a.m. on April 2nd. After the Titanic completed its trials, it was handed over from Harlan Wolff Shipyard to the owner of the White Colonel. Once the ship was handed over, the Titanic left Belfast and headed toward Southampton, where it arrived on April 4th at 11:15 a.m. Once it reached Southampton, it began preparation for its maiden voyage. Cargo was still stored, the hull was repainted, coal was put aboard, so on and so forth. On April 10th, at 12 p.m., Titanic set out on its maiden voyage and headed toward Cherbourg, France, where it would arrive at 6:15 p.m. After embarking and disembarking passengers, it would leave Cherbourg and head towards Queenstown, Ireland, where it arrived on April 11th at 11:30 a.m. Again, after embarking and disembarking passengers, the Titanic would head out towards New York, leaving Queenstown at 1:30 p.m. Titanic would continue the most southern route of the route set up by the major shipping companies in 1899. These routes were to take ships away from areas of known danger, or where they are more prevalent. You couldn't eliminate the dangers, but you could take them away from where they were more prevalent. The route Titanic was to take was to be run from January 15th to August 23rd. As you see by the slide, by the second day out, Titanic was speeding up 222 knots. From noon of the 14th to the time of the collision, Titanic had reached a speed of 22.29 knots. This speeding up would cause some newspapers to speculation that Titanic was set out to meet the speed record. Before we dive into that theory, let's first understand Titanic's propulsion. Titanic had aboard 3 engines, 2 reciprocating engines and 1 turbine engine, powered by 29 boilers broken up into 6 boiler rooms. steam from the boilers from passing through the two reciprocating engines, which powered the two outboard propellers. Steam exhaust from the reciprocating engines would then pass to a low pressure turbine, which would power the center propeller. Altogether, Titanic had a horsepower of 46,000, which would drive the ship at a cruising speed of 21 knots. The Cunard Line Fortuna held the speed record for the fastest crossing from 1909 to 1929, longer than any other ship. This 1912 publication has the cruising speed from Fortuna of 26.06 knots, where Titanic is listed at 21 knots. So in no way could Titanic actually try to outspeed the Fortuna and try to set the speed record. So the captain of the ship was White Star Line's most decorated captain, Captain E.J. Smith. He was set to retire after bringing Titanic back from New York to Southampton. Underneath Captain Smith was seven officers. Chief Officer Wilde, First Officer Murdoch, Second Officer Whitecollar, Third Officer Pittman, Fourth Officer Boxhall, Fifth Officer Lau, Sixth Officer Moody. Out of all seven, only four would survive the sinking. Titanic had a total of 891 crew members, broken up into three departments. The deck department consisted of the captain and the officers. The engine department consisted of the engineers and electricians. The petroleum department consisted of the purser's department, the stewards, and the stewardesses. On board Titanic was also 1,317 passengers, broken up into three classes. Amongst the first class of the world's elite, the celebrities of Titanic's time, including the richest man of war, 47-year-old John Jacob Astor, who was traveling with his 18-year-old pregnant wife. During the sinking, Madeline Astor would have a little place in life for number four, and John Jacob would ask if he could join his wife due to her delicate condition. He would be denied a place in the lifeboat and subsequently die in the disaster. When his body was recovered, it had a layer of coal dust on it, causing speculation that perhaps he died in one of the fallen tunnels. Also in first class was Benjamin Guggenheim, who during the later part of the sinking went back to his cabin along with his servant and they dressed in their finest outfits. When offered a lifebelt, Guggenheim would say, "We are dressed in our best and are prepared to go down like gentlemen." Also on board was Ida and Isidore Strauss. Isidore Strauss was one of the founders of the Macy's department store. Both would be offered a place within lifeboat 8, but Isidore would refuse after still women and children aboard the ship. Ida would then exit the lifeboat, and Isidore would tell her to go back in. She'd protest, saying, "We've been living together for many years, and where you go, I go." Isidore's body was later recovered while Edith went down with him. Lucy Duff Thornton and Sir Cosmo Duff Thornton had a different fate. They did not die before the Titanic at night. But instead, there are two of the 12 people to be saved in lifeboat number one. After the sinking, the crew members would tell Sir Cosmo Duff Thornton that they had lost their crew kits and they would have to buy new ones out of their own pockets. Taking pity on these crew members, Sir Cosmo Duff Thornton would buy them new kits once they reached shore. When the public caught wind of this, they thought it was a bribe so that they could have their own personal lifeboat of 12. So altogether, there are 2,208 people aboard Titanic, 1,496 were perished. If you're a member of the crew, you can see your chances of survival was very slim. If you're a member of the third class, your chance of survival was also very slim. Many third class passengers were later stated that they were held down below decks, either by locked doors or locked gates or by crew members. While we know dates before they came, there's only one plan out of all the blueprints of Titanic that has eight gates on it. Now the three gates on that blueprint, only one could have actually held passengers below deck. Unfortunately, there's no evidence that this gate actually did hold anybody back. Being in the port area of the ship, it would have flooded very early on in the sinking. All the other blueprints indicate no other gates, including the three on this blueprint. No gates have also been found within the bow section of the wreck or within the debris field that separates the bow section from the stern section. If these gates were in fact in the stern section of the wreck, due to its condition, the stern is unexplorable, and therefore, if the gates are there, they will never be found. So as of right now, either though we have an abundance of testimony saying there were gates, we don't know the location, and we don't know how many gates there actually were aboard the ship. Titanic has the most powerful wireless apparatus on the ocean, a 5-kilowatt Marconi wireless set. To operate it was senior wireless operator Jack Phillips and senior wireless operator Harold Bright. They would receive several ice warnings during Titanic's voyage. As you can see by the chart, out of the 7 warnings they received, only 4 of them were actually received by the bridge. But why was that? That has to do with what is called a master service brand. A master service brand is an indication to the wireless crew that that message was meant for the captain or the officers of the ship. Out of all the messages received by Titanic, only 4 have the prefix of MSG, same as the master service brand. And of those 4, all of them were received by Titanic's bridge. So it wasn't the wireless operators being lazy, they were in fact doing their jobs. After the disaster, Congress was put into Act of Radio Act Bill of 1912, which states that any message about threats to navigation took priority and must be turned into the bridge. It would also state that no message could be ignored or discriminated against. And as a fun fact, it also set SOS as the international call for help. So we do know that the Titanic officers and the captain knew they were coming to a region of ice. And my caller later on in his life would even state such.
On that night of April the 14th, we all, that is, the captain and officers, knew perfectly well that we were just about entering the region where ice might be sighted at that particular time of the year.
The key word there is might be sighted. That'll be important here in a second. So why weren't the ice warnings heeded to? After the Titanic sank, the U.S. created what is known as the International Ice Patrol, whose sole duty is to track ice flow. The first patrol started in 1913, and they are still doing it to this day. On their website, they give us little hints as to why the ice warnings were not heeded to. One of them being that the ice patrol provided accurate and timely iceberg information. Wireless technology at the time was still rather new. It was more of a novelty than an actual tool. Ships did not usually have a powerful wireless apparatus if they had one at all. And so in order to send a message for a distance, they had to send it from one ship to another ship to another ship until it reached the destination. This game of telephone not only increased the odds for errors creeping into the message, but it also caused timely delays for the message to be received. And at the same time, ships navigated by the stars and the moon and the sun. And they did so at certain times of the day. Between those 2 points, they went off what is called dead reckoning, where they guessed at where they were. And sometimes their guess, even though educated, were off by 7 miles. So any icebergs that they saw would have a wrong position attached to them. The ice patrol also states that to reduce risk, ships would have to slow down considerably, which would add additional sea miles and hours and costs. That's just as true today as it was in 1912. As my caller said, there is an area where ice might be spotted. These passenger lanes were traveled on a daily basis, with some ships like the Martini traveling them at 26 knots, and no ship hit an iceberg. So to slow down for potential danger was just adding cost. and mileage and delivery times, something that even the public today don't accept. But on the website for this NASA Ice Patrol, they would state that since their creation, no vessel in their warnings has ever flooded with an iceberg. So what is the weather like on the night of April 14th? Here are some first-hand accounts from survivors.
It is as smooth as the proverbial mill pond, not a breath of wind, and the sea like a sheet of glass, and a moonless night.
It was a clear night. There was no signs of any fog. There was no wind, you see. The sea was perfectly smooth. Every star in the heavens was visible, but there was no moon, so it was dark.
The skies were clear, the stars gleaming, with that brightness which only a keen, frosty air brings to them. And visibility was as good as it could be on a moonless night.
The sky was clear, the stars were shining, the sea was dead calm.
And the reverse of it, the ocean was as smooth as a pond.
She said the ocean is as smooth as a pond. That was kind of hard to hear. So with such clear conditions, it is believed that objects could be seen far out into the ocean. The lookout never had a pair of binoculars for taking. The life starlight rule was it was up to the captain's discretion as to whether or not the lookouts would receive binoculars. A lot of captains and officers at the time believed that binoculars were actually a hindrance to the lookouts, as they keep them glued to their eyes and narrow their view of the horizon. They thought it was best that the lookouts signal anything they saw without worrying about what it was. Because once they signaled it, it was up to the officer of the watch to make out what it was and devise a course of action. But Titanic's lookouts would receive a pair of binoculars by then second officer David Blair during the trip from Belfast to Southampton. Once the ship reached Southampton, Blair was replaced by second officer Lightoller, who would repeatedly tell the lookout that there was no binoculars for them. So with no moon and no binoculars, the lookout, 95 feet in the air, could have a 12-mile view of the horizon, but only have their eyes to rely on spotting an object. Their best bet of spotting an object was as it came over the horizon, it would start eclipsing the stars. On the night of April 14th, 1912, Frederick Fleet and Reginald Lee were in the Grub's Nest. Unfortunately, even though popular belief was icebergs would be seen on the horizon, they didn't start making out a black mass until about a half mile away. Fleetwood asked Lee, what is that? To which Fleetwood answered himself, saying, there's an ice ahead. Fleetwood then reached out to the crow's nest bell and rang it three times, indicating something seen ahead. Fleetwood then goes to the crow's nest telephone and ring up the bridge, asking if anybody's there. Six officers moving on the bridge for the answer, saying, yes, what do you see? Fleetwood called out, iceberg, right ahead. To which Moody would say, thank you, hang up the phone, and relay the lookout message to First Officer Murdoch. Murdoch would then make out the bird for himself and come up with a course of action. He recalled it a court of applications in the wheelhouse, right there, upon starboard, to which patients would begin to turn Titanic's helm counterclockwise four times, which would turn Titanic's rudder 40 degrees to the port, which would turn Titanic also to the port. But if the order was hard to starboard, why would Titanic turn to the port? That's because the order hard to starboard was not the direction Murdoch wanted Titanic to turn, but the direction he wanted Titanic's tiller to be pushed. When you push the tiller to starboard, you push the rudder to port, and the ship turns port. That harks back to the time where ships did not have steering wheels, and were actually driven slowly by the tiller and the rudder. And that didn't change until the 1930s. There's been recent accusations that Titian blundered the maneuver and drove the Titanic into the iceberg. But being that this was the way they did things for eons, it there's no reason why Hitchens should have made a mistake. After ordering Harvey Scarver, first Officer Murdoch was then to the engine room and telegraph and regained his vision full astern. To do this, they cut off steam to the Titanic's turbine engine as the only one to afford capacity, and then reversed it to resist the engine. Titanic would not begin to reverse until about a minute and 15 seconds. Until then, the engines would slowly wind down to a stop and start reversing. So Titanic would carry on and afford momentum. 37 seconds into Titanic's turn to port, Titanic would turn about 2 points or 22.5 degrees. 37 seconds is exactly the time of this audio clip. It's exactly how long it took before Titanic collided with the iceberg, and how long Murdoch, Fleet, and Lee, and Moody had a way of helping Titanic to avoid the iceberg.
Titanic, however, was neither the first ship nor the last ship to be called practically
on sinkholes. It wasn't until after World War I when people realized no matter how well you build ships, including warships, they could sink. But that Monkier, practically on sinkholes, went away. So what did the passengers and crew feel when Titanic struck the iceberg? Here's the first hand account.
I was like, when I felt the slight jar, not a sense of collision, but more a kind of shiver that ran through the ship.
I was about halfway between the officers' quarters, the entrance, the officers' quarters and the bridge, when the crash came. And it didn't break my step. She was doing full speed, and it didn't break my step.
I was in my cabin then. And all of a sudden, she came to a halt. There was no impact as such. It was just like jamming your brakes on the car.
She was going full speed, and she was thrown back. And the second time, she did the same thing. And the third time, she stopped dead.
Felt this bump, which felt like a train pulling into the station, a jerk.
And I noticed a slight jar, followed immediately by a second one, and the third one, which was quite strong enough to make me hold on to the bedpost.
But I didn't think she'd did it any, and I thought she'd dropped a blade from the propeller.
Just dozing off, and I felt a shock, similar to a train being pulled up in the station.
So as you see from these testimonies, Titanic's impact of the iceberg was very slight. In fact, it caused more curiosity amongst the crew and passengers than it actually did alarm. A lot of people didn't know what happened, the only indication being ice that had poured onto Titanic's decks. Eventually, though, people would realize that Titanic had stopped and had remained stopped for quite a while. And then concerns started to rise. At 12:10, the order for passengers to put on lifebelts was given. And at 12:15, Titanic's orchestra began to play, helping to calm the rising concern amongst the passengers. When Captain Smith went on his own inspection, he ordered Chief Officer Wilde to stop repairing Titanic's lifeboats. By 12:25, Captain Smith knew Titanic was damaged and knew it was going to sink. And Lightfall received permission to start loading the boats with women and children. Here to tell the story himself is Lightfall.
Now we've been running under a big head of steam, and the sudden stopping of the engines lifted every safety valve. And as a result, the steam roared off at all exhaust. The rock was absolutely deafening. Shout as loud as you like. No one could hear a word. I hadn't any clipped. And I asked him, by cutting my hands over his ear and yelling at the top of my voice, "Shall I get the women and children away, sir?" He just nodded. So I started to build the first boat. Just about now, thank goodness, the roar of escaping steam stopped.
Over here is a picture of one of the Titanic's collapsible lifeboats. The way they worked, they had a canvas side that you had a hoist step and it was to be used. That's not important right now, but it will be important for later. And as you see, an hour after Titanic struck the iceberg, the first lifeboat, number 7, was launched. But why didn't Titanic have enough lifeboats? That's because the Board of Trade Regulations based lifeboats on cubic feet of lifeboat space based on the gross tonnage of the ship. The regulations during the time the Titanic was built only went up to 10,000 tons, where Titanic added 46,000 gross tonnage, four times more than the regulations. Therefore, any ship built 10,000 gross tons or more was only obligated to have 9,625 cubic feet of lifeboat space. This only equal to occupancy of 925. Titanic was certified to carry 3,547, and we are discussed 2,208 were aboard the main voyage. But Titanic actually exceeded Board of Trade regulations. The 20 boats had half cubic feet of 11,327, 1,702 more than it was regulated to have. In all, Titanic lifeboats could handle 1,178 people, or 33% of its certified capacity, or 58% of those on a planned voyage. Unfortunately, though, the lifeboats were not filled all the way, with 37 people on average. Titanic 14-class A boats could handle 65 people. In all, 712 survivors is only 60% of the 1,178 that could have been saved. And in handout is a list of the times of the lifeboats being launched and the occupancy of it. Unfortunately, I didn't have enough time to really go over that. So once Captain Smith knew Titanic was going to sink, he told the wireless to start sending out the call for distress. He received on the coordinates 41 degrees, 44 minutes north, 50 degrees, 24 minutes west. This position actually lies 20 miles from where Titanic actually sank. 10 minutes later, Vauxhall was given new coordinates of 41 degrees, 46 minutes north, 50 degrees, 14 west, which reads 13 miles away from where Titanic actually sank. To this day, nobody knows why these coordinates were so far off. Thankfully, however, the rescue ship Carpathia would travel through where Titanic actually sank and find the lifeboats. At 12:57, Titanic used SOS. Unlike the popular myth, Titanic was not the first ship to use SOS. It's probably the first public major disaster to use SOS, but it was not. SOS was originally developed in 1908. At 2:12 a.m., April 15th, the last call of help from Titanic was heard. At 12:57, with Vauxhall's new position, was received by the rescue ship, the Carpathia. Here to tell the story of the receiving of this message is Captain Rostrom and wireless operator Gerald Cotto.
We only carried one operator. This system should have finished duty at midnight. Yet here he was, at 12:12, and he was still listening in. But he was on the very point of retiring.
She didn't call me, I called her. I took a batch of message for her, and with the intention of redirecting them onto her, I called her up. And the only reply I got that she'd struck ice. And I said, was it serious? And she said, yes, this is a CQD old man. So I took the position and on a scrap of paper and rushed up to the bridge with it. When I got on the bridge, I contacted the office of the watch, and the information didn't seem as though it sunk as fast as I thought it ought to, so I rushed down the ladder and knocked on the captain's cabin, and that's all right, I rushed in.
I can remember my below opening, the door on the other end of my bunk, which communicated with the chart room. I had the prisoner turned in and wasn't asleep, and gradually I said to myself, who the blazes is this cheating beggar coming into my cabin without knocking?
And he said, who the hell, or which to that effect?
Then the first officer was blurting out the facts, and you may be sure, I was there, she was wide awake.
So I said, well, the Titanic struck ice, sir, and she's in distress. I've got the position here. So he said, well, do it for me, and put a dressing gown on and then.
All right, I said then. Tell him we're coming along as fast as we can.
When Titanic's lifeboats were being prepared, both passengers and crew noticed a light on the horizon of a nearby ship. To try to contact this light during the sinking, they began to fire rockets 7 minutes after the first lifeboat was launched. They also tried to warp the ship using the powerful mortar hand. Again, to tell the story in their own words is Quartermaster Rao and Fourth Officer Vauxhall.
I saw a lifeboat in the lower, and saw the sign. I reported it to the bridge. I asked them if they knew there was a boat being lowered. They said they did and wanted to know what it was. I said I was the after quartermaster. They asked if I knew where the distress rockets were. I said yes. They said bring them on the bridge. But when Captain Smith told me to bring them up, he told me to fire one and fire one every 5 or 6 minutes. After about 2 or 3 minutes, he said to me, he said, call that light up. Tell her we're a Titanic sinking, please get all your boats ready. She never answered.
Well, ask the captain, shall I send up some distress rockets? We started sending off these distress rockets, Quartermaster and I, which, but I never knew how many I had fired. I knew very well that there were some in the box. The box holds a dozen, and when I told the captain, I said, there are still some in there, sir, but I don't know how many I fired. We also called up their ship as she drew closer with a Morse lamp, a very powerful Morse lamp. I didn't see any reply. Some of the passengers that were on the bridge said that they didn't see a reply.
The mystery ship eventually disappeared. And at 1:15 a.m., they came fired his last rocket. As Foxhall said, the number of rockets fired that night is unknown. As they began to sink even further, panic began to break out among the passengers aboard, and the officers were forced to use their revolvers. At 1:25 at 1:14, this officer allowed fire twice down the tank's hull to prevent jumpers from jumping into the boat. At 2 a.m. around boat C, two shots are reported to have been fired. On the port side, around 2:05, light colors have the crew lock arms around the boat, keeping people from rushing it. Light colors then pulled his revolver and threatened to shoot anybody to rush the boat. At boat A, around 12:15, two other shots were heard, with accounts saying that they were fired upon passengers, but then the shooter shooting himself afterwards. Unfortunately, the identity of this person is conflicting amounts of testimony, which is not positively identified who it was. At the water reached Titanic's boat deck, collapsible A floated off the bridge. The camera size was never erected on this collapsible, and those who were able to climb aboard the boat had to stand in knee-deep water all night long. Collapsible B also floated off the ship, but upside down. Those that were able to climb aboard that one had to stay up all night, balancing, hoping that they themselves would not plunge into the icy waters. With no more lifeboats aboard, passengers began to make their way stern towards the tank's poop deck. And Titanic's eight musicians began to play their last song, and he believed in what to him near my God to be. Wallace Hartley was saying in a letter that would be the last song he'd play if he was ever shipwrecked. As the water made its way across the tank's deck and reached the first funnel, the angle of the ship and the pressure of the water caused it to collapse. Weighing 60 tons each and kill anybody that was underneath it, including possibly John Jacob Astor. As the water reached the second funnel, the same thing would occur. Eventually, they came to reach the point where his loaded engines can no longer pull out the power, and Titanic's lights begin to dim to a bluish red. Then the lights would blink off once, twice, possibly three times, until the lights would go out forever. Titanic would then be illuminated, outlined by the starry skies, with some survivors saying there was an eerie glow about the ship that allowed them to watch the unfolding tragedy. Since the tank reached the angle where its hull no longer supports the weight, the bottom day currently has this angle being around 11 to 15 degrees. Survivors place it at about 30 to 45 degrees. I'm under the belief that it's probably a little bit above. The ship probably began to break apart at 11 to 15 degrees, but it's not fully break apart until it gets a higher angle. After the ship sank, even though a survivor could call the ship breaking in half, it was not believed that the ship had actually broken in half, until it was found in two pieces on the ocean floor, separated by 2,000 feet. Once the ship broke in half, the spare section was to stay afloat, and though the born would be saved. But it seemed against blood and against tips. When it reached about 1 degree Nemo, it sat there and bobbed for about 4 to 5 minutes before it began to submerge itself. As it did, it leaned to the port and rotated 180 degrees. At 2:20 a.m. on April 15th, it made 8 degrees away. When it did so, it found 1,400 people in the 23 headwaters of North Atlantic. Well, a hypothermia within 15 minutes. None of them were lifeboats. They were too scared to go back. They were too scared to go to the Grand. As there were so many of them, they were afraid that they too would be drawn down into the water. And plus, it was dark. They didn't know where to go. So instead, the survivor had to listen as the loved ones, husbands, wives, pleaded for help, and they tried to fill the pain in the night. Once they cried again, sent off the law to take Bill 14 and try to find survivors. He was able to pull out only 4 people from the water, including first class passenger William Hoyt, who was bleeding from the nose and the mouth. He used those saved from the Atlantic, he would eventually die and be buried at sea along with 4 other people. Once they cried again, the survivors had nothing to do but wait. Many of them didn't even know that the rescue ship was on the way. To the north, the northern lights added a slight distraction to what had occurred. To the south, some saw a shooting star, and then another one, almost in the exact same spot. It was soon realized that it wasn't a shooting star, but in fact a ship firing rockets. Fourth officer Boxhall and boat 2 was able to get to light 3 flares trying to attract the ship towards the lifeboats. The ship firing rockets was the rescue ship, the Carpathia. To tell the story of the rescue is Captain Rockford in his own words.
I then gave the firing orders to the first officer. Company's rockets to be fired from 3 a.m. every quarter of an hour to reassure the Titanic. At 4 o'clock, I stopped the engines. We were there. As if in corroboration of that judgment, I saw a green light just ahead of us, no doubt. That must be a boat I knew. And below was the first boat containing survivors. They were in charge of one officer. I asked that this officer should come to me as soon as he was on board, and him I put the heart-rending inquiry, knowing with a terrible certainty what his answer was to be. The Titanic has been down. Yes, he said. One word that meant so much that the man's voice broke from it. But there was no time for vain regress. Daylight was just setting in, and what a sight that new day gradually revealed. Boats of the last ship fainted. From that moment, we went on picking them up. Slowly, we cruised from boat to boat. And as we neared the end of our questing, one gathered the enormity of the disaster. It wasn't for us to remain, especially as about this time, 8 o'clock, we saw another ship coming. We signaled her now, asking her to continue searching as we were about to make for New York.
As the Carpathia steamed towards New York, and the disaster was realized on shore, the White Star allowed permission for McKay Bennett to retrieve the dead. McKay Bennett was set up on April 17th, arriving at the spot where the Titanic sank on April 2nd. April 20th, As you see, a lot of the bodies were brought back to Halifax, where most of them are still buried to this day. 129 bodies were buried at sea, and 2 were seen but never recovered. Out of the 1,496 people who lost their lives, only 340 bodies can be accounted for, leaving 1,156 unaccounted for. The Carpathia would reach New York on April 18th at 9 p.m. They're waiting for the ship to catch a glimpse of the ship and its survivors, with over 10,000 people swimming in the rain. When Carpathia reached his pier, his cell passed it to where Titanic was docked at Pier 59. And there he let out the last remaining remnants of the ship, his lifeboats. It then sets out to his own pier, Pier 54, and docked at 9:30, after which the survivors of the Titanic disembarked. The very next day, the U.S. would begin their inquiry into the disaster, headed by William Alden Smith. The inquiry lasted from April 19th to May 25th, with a total of 86 witnesses. In England, they also held an inquiry into the disaster, starting on May 2nd and ending on July 3rd, with a total of 97 witnesses called. Both inquiries would not find fault in Titanic's crew, the White Star Line, or Harland Wolff. Instead, they find fault in outdated practices and outdated procedures and outdated regulations. Titanic would remain a mystery on the sea floor for 73 years until it was found on September 1st, 1985 by Dr. Robert Ballard. He'd find the Titanic using the autonomous vehicle Argo, which had a still camera on it and a video camera on it. Towing the Argo across the ocean and patterns called mowing the lawn, they sat there and watched countless hours of sea floor, hoping to come across wreckage. They did come across wreckage, but they didn't know what they found until they came across one of Titanic's boilers. It was then after that they found the bow section. In 1986, Robert Ballard would return to Titanic and dive 2.5 miles down to explore the wreck using the ROV, or remote operated vehicle, Jason Jr. It was also that year that they found the stern section. Since then, countless dives to the wreck have occurred. And since Robert Ballard did not bring up any artifacts from the wreck, he cannot claim ownership of it. Instead, in 1987, another expedition went out and actually retrieved objects from the wreck. And they claimed ownership of it because of that, and they created the firm RMS Titanic Incorporated, which still holds the title to the wreck today. In 2012, the Titanic disaster turned 100 years old. Here to tell us what happened is a short little video.
More than 2.5 miles below the surface, the wreckage of the Titanic rests on the seafloor, both as a memorial and a living laboratory. 100 years ago, the world's most advanced passenger steamship struck an iceberg. On April 15, 1912, it sank, losing 1,496 lives. The legend of the Titanic was larger than her size. Finding the wreck site opened a door to not only exploration and scientific study, but to salvage as well. With ties to multiple nations, steps needed to be taken to preserve and protect the integrity of the wreck site. For the U.S., NOAA and the State Department negotiated an international agreement with representatives of the U.K., Canada, and France. This agreement recognizes the wreck site as a memorial to those who died and a wreck of great archaeological, historical, and cultural importance. The agreement set rules for research, exploration, and salvage. The memory of the Titanic lives on in movies, books, and museums, but it's the protection of the wreck site that will continue to yield clues about the fateful ship and its passengers.
So as that video said, it's through books, movies, and museums that the story of Titanic lives on. Unlike any other ship or shipwreck, the Titanic holds a mass public appeal. So much so that museums across multiple continents have been created and are being created, including a full-size replica of the ship in China. And it's through these classrooms like this that, in the words of Celine Dion, Titanic and his story will go on. Yeah. You should fill out a survey.